root fire of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, to which you were also called, and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses.
It's good to know that we are called to eternal life. It is good to know we are called to eternal life. It's also good to know that we are called into a fight. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Whether you like it or not, you are in a fight. But he called this fight the good fight. Tell somebody, I said the good fight.
The good fight.
It is the good fight. The fight of faith is a fight, a good fight. The fight of faith is a good fight. We are going to know why it is a good fight, because there are some battles in life that we all have to go through. Some go through it, battles from friends and families, battles from spouses, battles from co-workers, battles from neighbors. Most of these battles, they come from people that know you. But the word of God says, we must fight the good fight. The good fight of faith. There is a fight you and I must fight in order to lay hold on eternal life. Because many adversaries don't want you to make it to heaven. But I'm convinced that you will make it.
Amen.
Everyone who must inherit eternal life must fight this fight. The fight of faith. Unlike any other fight, this fight of faith is a good fight. You are going to know why it's a good fight. Number one, it's a good fight because a fight that the battle has already been won by Jesus, and you are called to fight that fight, is that not a good one? Because the victory has already been settled. So whatever you are going through, whatever you and I must do to accomplish that particular heart desire and ambition, remember that Jesus Christ has already won the battle for you, and that is why it is a good fight. The fight of faith is good because it is a done deal. Talk to someone and say, it's a done deal. Whatever you are going through, whether you believe it or not, as I've said, somebody before you have gone through it and they did not die. And there is no doubt you will not be the last one to go through it. Remember, you are just going through. You are not staying there. You are going through. There is a passage for you through that battle. And at the end of it, there is victory for you. I see you as a winner.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I see you as a winner. The good fight. That's the title. The good fight. It's a good fight because it has already been won. When Jesus on the cross of Calvary, in John chapter 19, from verses 29 to 30, he says, it is finished. When they gave him the word, he said, it is finished. In other words, that battle has already been won. You are just going through it. Because the destination has already been defined. It is a good fight. The breakthrough you want is finished. Amen? The breakthrough you desire is concluded. I didn't hear anyone say
amen.
It seems you are not here. The breakthrough you desire is completed.
Amen.
Otherwise, Jesus would be alive. He said it is finished. How come he said it is finished? But you are going through it. You are going through it because he has gone through it ahead of you. You are going through it, but the end has already been concluded. Do you believe that?
Yes.
The good fight. The good fight. The good fight. It's a good fight because Jesus said, it is finished. It is finished. Number two. Jesus said, it's a good fight. Because without faith, it is impossible to please God. The fight of faith is always good because it is the only fight that pleases God. The fight of faith. According to Hebrews 11:6, it says, without faith, it is impossible to please the Lord. And I know we want to please God. And for you to please God, the only way you can please God through your predicament is to see that this fight is not only good, it's been completed, it's finished, and Jesus Christ has won the battle. And so, you too will win.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You need to be with me because don't feel dejected. Don't feel discouraged that as the year is coming to an end, there are still some battles that have been there. And they are still showing their ugly heads. They are showing their ugly heads because they needed your attention. But I want to assure you that if you can believe what Jesus Christ said, that it is finished, then see your victory, that your victory is already accomplished.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God. You see? The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God. That also tells you that you are in a warfare. And the only way we can win this battle is to use the appropriate weapon. The appropriate weapon is the weapon that God, that is mighty only in God. We are not talking about AK-47. We are not talking about weapons of man. We are only talking about the weapons of God Himself that is designed for you to walk you through the problem and give you the ultimate goal. The fight, the good fight. You don't have to be reminded that every day of our lives, we are always involved in a fight. You see that things are not going the way you thought they should go. And the discouragement around, and the dejection and rejection, and the things you want to be that has not been, and the pain and the agony and the grief that we all carry from time to time, and the bitterness at times that want to come because of the things that we thought should be but has not been. How do I react? How do I respond to this? I'm going through this. But God says, it's a good fight. Not everyone wants to fight and forsake their faith. But some of these things that we go through make some people to turn their back at God. Because they don't see it as something good. But God says it's a good fight. Because even Jesus Christ fought that fight. Criticisms will come from friends and families. Criticisms will come from church members. As one sister said this morning, that is the fight that God has called us to fight. In as much that it comes to you, they want to steal your heart. They want to lure you away from God. But you have to stand up, as that song that we sang. Stand up for Jesus. You have to stand up. Every time you stand to resist unrighteousness, that is the response of the good fight. Hallelujah.
Amen.
1 Timothy chapter 1, from verse 19 to 20. 1 Timothy chapter 1, 19. Having faith and a good conscience, which some having rejected, concerning the faith, have suffered shipwreck. A lot of people have come and gone. They have started with God, but they are no longer there because they have suffered a shipwreck. What happened to them? They could not fight the good fight. And look at verse 20. Of whom are Arminius, and Alexander, whom I surrendered or delivered to Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. You can see what happened to those that blaspheme. So along the journey of our faith, some things will come to try you. That is not the time to start blaspheming. That is not the time to start talking about against God. When those things are not happening, God has already finished them, but the enemy doesn't want you to enjoy what God has already finished. It's a fight of faith, and that is why it's most very interesting. It's a fight of what you have to believe before you become somebody. You cannot betray your conscience because you know it is true. And that is why it's a good fight. Some people you know that have been there before you, coming to church before you, they might just fall aside or fall by the way, but you don't have to fall. Hallelujah.
Amen.
What about John chapter 6, verse 66? Jesus also experienced this fight, and he also resisted and defeated the innuendos that came with it. John chapter 6, verse 66. Look at Jesus as he fought his own fight. From that time, many of his disciples, they went back and walked with him no more. Even Jesus was deserted. So don't be afraid of people deserting you. You are not the first one, and you will not be the last one. Why did they desert Jesus? Because of his faith. Look at verse 60. Therefore, many of his disciples, when they heard this, what did they hear? They hear his teaching. They heard, rather, his teaching. And what did they say? They said, this is a hard saying. Who can understand it? People will leave you because they find you difficult. People will leave you because they find you principled. People will leave you because they find you disciplined. A lot of people are not disciplined. And how do you expect indisciplined people to react to a disciplined person? They won't leave you. Hallelujah. Amen. But you have to fight the good fight. You have to fight the good fight. You have to stand up for what is right. You have to stand up for what is true. You cannot betray your conscience. That is very hurting. Because you'll be suffering in silence. You know what to do. You know what they are doing is wrong. But you are mute. You kept quiet. You are suffering. You have to fight the good fight. From that time, many of the disciples went back and walked with him no more. They stopped talking to Jesus. So people will stop talking to you because of your faith. But you don't have to stop talking to them because of your faith. There are some things people will do to you, you will never be able to do because of your faith. And there are some things that you will be able to do that some others will not be able to do because of your faith. So where do you stand? If you don't stand up for what you believe, then you are not a true believer. And that corroborates with the song, the hymn that we sang today. Stand up! Whoever chose that song was God-led. Stand up for Jesus. 1 Timothy again. Chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. I am telling you, we are in the last days. Many people that you knew that have been forefront of what you now believe, you'll be surprised that they are no longer there. It's not strange. It's not new. What will be new will be you if you fall aside. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. Now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith. From the faith. They will stop coming to church. They will stop studying the Bible. They will stop fellowshipping. Giving heed to deceiving spirit. I told you this morning, deceiving spirit are spirits that deceive people. If you now begin that I've known to be a child of God, whenever I ask you something, you now lie, thinking that I don't know. You know? Yes, I don't know. But you know. And that is more haunting. Because you are betraying your conscience. You are rubbishing yourself, your personality. You are discrediting yourself. You are discrediting your own image. You are making yourself to be disreputable. So everywhere you go, man will not hold you. I mean, they will not take your word seriously. Even when you want them to take your word seriously. Why? Because you are lying. So, and doctrines of demons. These are believers who once believed the word of God, but because they could not fight the good fight, they are now opening up. They have now opened up themselves to doctrines of demons. What are the doctrines of demons? Many of them. Many of them. Doctrines of demons are doctrines that Jesus Christ did not teach. Anything that is not scriptural is of the demon, is of demons. Anything that is of truth that you can establish from the word of Jesus, that is the truth. It says, sanctify them, John 17:17, by thy truth. Thy word is truth. Anything that is not the truth, it is the demon. Doctrines of demons. And unfortunately, a lot of believers today, a lot of church people, are falling prey to doctrines of demons. Just as our sister said, do this, don't do that. You have to do this, don't have to do that. Yes, you follow your pastor, you follow the men of God that God has placed over you, but to the point that they themselves are following Christ. Paul will say, follow me as I follow Christ. Because it is true, God has placed leaders over us. But those leaders are not Lord over us. They are to help us to know the truth. Hebrews 13:17 says, obey those that have rule over you, so that they will give good account of you. Every pastor, bishop, prophet, or whoever is pastoring over people is accountable to God. And that is why we must believe what they teach us. But also, you have a responsibility. As you know, this is a Bible-believing church. Everything we teach you is from the word of Jesus. And we establish it here. This is where we banish any heresy. Except you yourself, you have heretic beliefs or heretic tendencies. That is why you can fall prey to heresy. But if you are not gullible, you are not deceivable, you want to know the truth, as you hear the truth from your pastor, you write it down and you go back home and you check it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This is how we fight the good fight. Turn to somebody and say, fight the good fight.
Fight.
It is your responsibility. And that was why Paul was warning Timothy, the pastor. He was warning Timothy, the pastor, said, fight the good fight of faith. So it's not only the pastor that will fight the good fight of faith. Members of the church must fight the good fight of faith, because we are all exposed to wrong influences. You open the TV and you see what I'm talking about. We are all exposed to evil tendencies. You walk down the high street, you will see the evil tendencies. How can you exonerate yourself? How can you immune yourself from all this? Fight the good fight of faith. So they turned their back at Jesus, but Jesus fought the good fight of faith. And in verse 2 of 1 Timothy 4, speaking lies in hypocrisy. Do you wonder how many people speak lies today, even in the church? They are not of God. Anyone that is lying perpetually is not born again. Why are we afraid to say who is born again from who is not born again? The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, it said, love does not behave unseemly. So anyone that is born of God, we have a pattern of behavior. If it's outside love, then you can put it low, those who are faking it. If somebody says he's a Christian and he stopped talking to you, or keeping malice, or start fighting you, it's not born again. Hallelujah. So you have to fight that good fight. Don't let that spirit get to you, because that is unseemly behavior. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Will you for any reason betray God and betray your conscience? Verse 2, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron. What that means is that you keep lying, lying to people, lying to pastors, lying to God, deceiving people. Gradually, what is happening is that you are searing your conscience from being sensitive. You are no longer sensitive to the truth anymore. You now believe in lies. Your friends tell lies. You yourself tell lies. Your family tell lies. You sear your conscience. Don't do that. You have to fight the good fight. You have to fight against anything that wants to make you a liar. Do we have liars here today? Can any liar say praise the Lord? Hallelujah. Praise. They are not here. Hallelujah. They are not here. They are not here. Forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving. These are another doctrines of demons. Don't marry. Marry from this world. Only this world. Or don't even marry at all. See? God wants us to marry. Marry the one you love. Marry the one you know you will spend the rest of your life with. God will not give you somebody you don't love. God will give you somebody you love. If you don't like them, God has not given you. Did I get that? Amen.
Amen.
If you look at them and say, oh God, God has not given you. Amen. I don't know who gave you those words. Somebody you want to marry, somebody you will see and you will love in total. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Commanding to abstain from foods. These are doctrines of devils. Don't eat that. There are no food taboos in God. Every food must be eaten provided you bless them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Bless them with thanksgiving. Father, thank you for this food. Because I know when it gets into my tummy, it's going to bless me. It's not going to give me tummy ache. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Abstaining from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving. God created those foods. Those foods to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. How many of them are here today? Raise up your hand. Those that believe and know the truth. Amen?
Amen.
For every creature, verse 4, can we read that together? Every creature of God is
good.
Is what?
Good.
Every creature of God is good and nothing to be refused. If it is received with thanksgiving. Verse 5. For it is sanctified by the word of God and prayer. So if you are just that family that once you see the food, you forget about prayer. It's wrong. Yes, you are going to eat the food. Food, you are going to come into my tummy. Just wait a minute. Let me first pray. Hallelujah. And you sanctify the food in the name of Jesus and then you eat. And you are satisfied. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
A good fight. It's a good fight because even if they say that they poison food, it will not affect you. Because Jesus Christ said in Mark chapter 16 that in my name, even if they eat anything that is poisonous, it shall not hurt them. Amen?
Amen.
That is how it should be. The good fight. It's a good fight because it has been won already. It's a good fight because all you need to do is just believe. Believe in God. It's a good fight. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 20. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 20. He said, believe the Lord and you shall be established. Believe his prophet and you shall prosper. What are the examples of the fight of faith? In 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2 to 3. Look at it. And the things which you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. That is what I'm doing. I'm looking for faithful people. I'm not looking for deceivers. I'm looking for people that are committed to God. There's no way you can be committed to God that you not be committed to your church. Look at verse 3. You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. How do we fight this fight? Number one, endure hardship. Remember I said you are not the only one going through it. And you will not be the last one. Endure hardship. For you know that this is what God has called you to. And you must fight the good fight of Jesus. Good fight of faith. Do you know that Jesus Christ also fought the good fight? Endure hardship. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, did what? Endured the shame. Endured the cross, despised the shame. Isn't it? And has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. You too must endure. Talk to somebody, say, endure.
Endure.
You must. At times we endure, there's no money. At times we endure loneliness, we don't have a spouse. At times we endure, we don't have a child. How much more when you have children, you don't have money to provide for them. You can't even afford the Christmas gift. Endure. Because there will be many more Christmases and you'll be able to provide. Amen? Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Am I talking to some people here? Praise God. Jesus is our example. Fighting the good fight of faith. He endured. He endured the cross. He endured the devil. The nailing on the cross. That's our Savior. They put the thorns, crown of thorns on his head. And they pressed it in. And there was blood everywhere. They put the sword, pierced it by the side, and blood came and water came. And by his stripes, we were healed. He knew what he did, what he was doing. If he had not done it, you and I would not be here today. Hallelujah. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, the scripture says, do you not know that those who run in a race all wrong, but only one received the prize. Run in such a way, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 24. Run in such a way that you may obtain it. Obtain what? The prize. So there's a way you have to run to obtain. That's why love, it does not behave itself unseemly. If you are not running in such a way that pleases God, if you are not running in such a way that pleases the God of faith, you will not obtain, but you will obtain.
Amen.
Because you will run in such a way to obtain. You will do the service of God in such a way to be blessed. You don't do the service of God grumbling. You don't come to church grumbling. You don't decide to come late because you don't want to see some faces. No. Because as you are thinking it, God is seeing your heart. Why are you coming late? Why are you not studying the Bible? Why are you fighting one another? Those are the things. So you may be coming to church, but once you are not doing it in such a way that God ordained, you may forfeit your blessing. So Number one, endure difficulty. Number two, watch your lifestyle, the way you live. Watch your lifestyle. Say, run in such a way that you may obtain. So there's a way I have to run. There's a way I have to do things. If I'm a child of God, if I don't study the Bible, then I'm not doing things to please God. If I only study the Bible when I feel like, then I am not living. You see? If you're in a church and you are not committed to God in that church, you are not doing things to please God. That's what it means. Verse 26. Therefore, I run. Turn somebody and say, I run.
I run.
It's personalized. Everyone has to run. That's why I was trying to tell my sister that everyone has to run. If your pastor failed to run, then run. Overtaking is allowed. Amen. Overtaking is allowed. It's not because I came to church before you. You might come to church and be a church member later in life, but then what you are doing before God has amounted to great blessing. So overtaking is permitted. Therefore, I run thus, not with uncertainty. Everybody say uncertainty.
Uncertainty.
Can you imagine some people coming to God, coming to church with uncertainty? They are neither here nor there. No! I don't want to be uncertain, man. I don't want to be vague. I want to be relevant. Praise God. You see? Your own fight may not be a good fight of faith if you switch on. You keep switching on and off. Today you are with God, tomorrow you are not with God. No, you have to be consistent. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
And number three, Philippians chapter 3, verse 12. How do we fight this fight? One, endure difficult times. Two, watch your lifestyles. Watch your lifestyle so I don't fall prey to the lies of the devil. And number three, press on. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 12, not that I have already attained. Excuse me, I've not made it yet. I've not made it yet. I've not reached everyone that God wanted to reach. We have only taken West on sea, on South and on sea. We need to take the whole of Essex. We need to take the whole of United Kingdom. And God wants laborers. This is the vision. Not that I have already attained or I'm already perfect. Who is perfect? We are on the way to being perfect. Not that I've already attained or I'm already perfect, but what do? I press on that I may hold of that for which Christ Jesus has laid hold of me. Do you know that we have been arrested by Jesus? It's because Jesus Christ arrested us, that's why we are here. We could have been in the pub or been in the disco or be doing some other things on drugs, but we are not there. We are here, hearing the word of God. So if this is my life, why don't I just give my whole to God? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Press on towards your vision. Yes, we know it's December. Just don't worry. If the vision is still in you, then that means that the vision is alive. It's just a matter of time. It's only you that can kill that vision if you stop thinking about it. But because you are still thinking about it, you need to press on. Hallelujah. Talk to someone and say, press on. That is how to fight the good fight. It's a good fight. I will not only endure the shame, I will not only endure the hardness, I will watch my life so that my life is consistent to what God wants me to do. And then I will press on to fulfill my vision. I know time is going. I know age is increasing, but so long that vision is in me, I know I will not die until I fulfill the vision. If you have the fear of death, do you know the reason why the fear of death is lingering? It's because you are visionless. Let me tell you the secret. Devil cannot kill you. That's certain. God does not kill people unless they are wicked. Now, what happened therefore is this. The only way you can stay out of that fear of death is this. Hold on to the vision. Cast a vision for God. Tell God what you want to do for Him and be consistent. Now, God heard you. God will not take you away until that vision is fulfilled. Because that vision will bring you glory. And God wants to be glorified. He said in Isaiah that you will all be righteous and be all be righteous to inherit the land. The work of my hand. That I may be glorified. God wants to be glorified in your life. Will you allow Him? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Look at verse 13 and 14 of that same one that we are reading. Philippians 3, 12. 13 and 14. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind. That's another trick of the devil. He doesn't want you to forget the pain. He doesn't want you to forget the disappointment. But you must forget about them. Because everyone in life do go through those pain. We do go through that rejection. Because if you don't forget about them, it will tie you down to the past. And you start living your past even in the now. So forget those things which are behind. And reach forward to the things which are ahead of you. Can you see? That is the vision. What is your ambition? What are the things you want to do in life that will keep you going? Hallelujah.
Amen.
I press toward the goal of the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let that ambition be something that will bring glory to God. Lord, I want to be an instrument to win people to God. Lord, help me to keep me so that I can preach your word. Lord, I want to do this for you. I want to do this for my people. That is a good vision. Praise God.
Amen.
Isaiah 54, verse 13. All your children shall be taught by the Lord, and great shall be their peace. God wants you to teach your children about God, so that they can have peace and you too have peace. So it's our responsibility, even if the children are disobedient, rebellious. Remember, it's a good fight. It's still a good fight. Make it a good fight. Teach them the word of God. Find ways of talking to them about God. That is how to win them over. Because it will bring you peace if you do. If you teach them, it will equip them to continue fighting the good fight after you have gone. And look at verse 14. 14a says, in righteousness you shall be established. God wants you and I to be established in doing right. That is the whole essence of being a Christian. We must not be perpetrators of evil. It's not until you call the name of Satan or you worship idols that you can say you are evil practitioner. If you are living a life of lies, you are still evil practitioner. If you are doing things that Jesus Christ did not teach, you are still evil practitioner. So, the Lord says here, in righteousness you shall be established. Turn to yourself and say, I shall be established in righteousness. Only right thing can establish one. Only right thing. If the church needs to be established, we all have to do right thing. It's not enough to be playing hanky-panky and deceiving one another. We have to start living, practicing the truth. Otherwise, where are we going? Where are you going? Nowhere unless you practice the truth. You cannot afford to hurt your conscience by doing the wrong thing. Every time you do the wrong thing, you are hurting your own conscience. Righteousness keep your conscience alive. Righteousness keep your conscience alive. Verse 15. Indeed, they shall surely assemble. I love that. Who are the people doing the assembly? The wrong people. The people around you that don't want you to do what is right. You see them all around. You say you have to apply wisdom. What wisdom? What wisdom? That is lies. The only wisdom is the application of the word of God. And that is the true wisdom. Every other thing that they call wisdom is lies. He said the true wisdom is the one that came from heaven. That is the word of God. Apply the word of God, then you'll be truly wise. And all of them are about applying wisdom, lying. Where are they going to? Where are they today? You cannot lie and get through with God. You can only say the truth and get through with God. Never think families cannot assemble against you or friends. Said they shall surely. It's certainly they will get it. At workplace, in the family, at home. Why are they gathering? They did that to Jesus, remember? They will always gather when you see somebody say, I'm going to stand up for truth. People will gather and say, no. But don't let their no, rejection, make you also to play ball with them. Otherwise, how can God have his way? God is depending on you in that association to lighten them, to show them the light. You cannot afford to switch off your light so that you can mingle well with them. Don't be Joneses with Mr. Jones. It doesn't work that way. Because of your faith in God, because you decide to stand up for what is right, if you press on and fight the good fight of faith, see what Jesus said will happen. Whoever assembled against you shall fall. If you press on, they will surely fall. Hallelujah. Amen. And when they fall, you'll be the one to carry them. Because they will come back to you and look at you. You'll be the one to accept them. That is the purpose of God. Not to destroy relationship, but to build relationship. So many of Jesus' disciples deserted him because of his principled life, because of his faith. And Jesus Christ turned to his disciple, said, do you also, the true disciple, the 12, he turned to them and said, do you also want to leave? And look at Brother Peter. Where are we going to go? You are the one that has the word of life. And he went on to say, we have come to believe and to know and to believe that you are Christ, the Son of the living God. That is conviction. And that's what I'm praying for you. That you're not just a follower, you'll be convinced to be a follower. Don't be put back because people left you. The people you trusted. The people that left Jesus, were they not disciples? Disciples were trusted people. It took time to train them. So don't be afraid of people that leave you. Only the trusted people will leave you. They will leave you because they cannot stand your truth. They cannot stand with your truth. They cannot. They always want to resist your truth. So please be encouraged. As you lose friends, you will gain new friends. You will gain the proper ones. They will go because they are not ready. They will go because they cannot fight a good fight. And then God will send people to you that will stay with you forever. They will send to you the true friends. Say, so I am the true vine. So there are other vines that are not true. Say, so my father is the vine dresser. And you are my branch. And every branch you think that does not bear fruit, take it away. May you not be taken away.
Amen.
To take away is that you stop being serviceable to God. You stop being useful to God. You stop being profitable to God. So catch up whatever you can do for God, so that God can account for you. So whoever does not bear fruit takes it away. But whoever bears fruit, he prunes. The pruning might be uneasy. The pruning might be difficult. The pruning might be what you are going through. No husband, no wife, no child, no job. You pray, you fast, but the pain is still there. If I were you, I will set my eyes on the Lord. I will set my eyes on Him. He knows where I am. He knows where you are. Lastly, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. Hear the word of God. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Verse 8. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved His appearing. So Father, we thank You. For the entrance of Your word that gave light and understanding to the simple. None of me, but all of you is what I pray for the people. None of me, but all of you of Your word that will live forever. Direct these ones, O God, to fight the good fight. Because the battle has already been won. Doesn't matter what we are going through. God knows the pain. We cry, and those tears are precious before God. But just keep on. Keep on keeping on. Endure the hardship. Watch your lifestyle. Press on. Don't allow anyone to derail you. And I can assure you, because you have a vision, an ambition, God will give you grace to accomplish them. Only stay committed to God. So, Father, thank You. Is there anyone here that wants to surrender his heart or hearts to Jesus? Is there anyone here that have not yet known Jesus or made Him His Lord and Savior? Is there anyone here that wants to be born again? Is there anyone that wants to start living the life of truth? Is there anyone here that wants to stop living lies? If you are out there, why don't you just ask God to forgive you of sins and ask Him to save you? That you have heard the word that pastor have preached and you believe is the word of God for the throne of God for you. Why don't you ask God to help you to practice the truth? Ask Him to give you a new heart and a new spirit. Ask Him to envision you. What is that thing that people don't want me to do? Well, I know God wants me to do it. I may not have the money here now, but I have a vision. And if God has given the vision, He will also make provision. Why don't you ask Him to keep you? As long as you stand for Jesus to keep you. There's an evil terrain and we are all living in. But let God keep us so that we don't fall prey to the evil. Lord, we thank You. Lord, we bless You. For all that we have done, for all that we need to do, for all that we have not done, for all that You have been telling us to do that we refuse. Lord, have mercy. Give us another chance. Your word is truth. Sanctify us by Your truth. Thank You, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Come on, clap those hands together for the Lord. Amen.